Thank you very much, everybody, and thank you for having me here. I'm so honored to be invited to speak with all of you and to share ideas, and I've been blown away, impressed, and honestly quite intimidated, sweating right here on the side listening to everybody. I think I'll officially be the most immature person and probably the least intellectual person that you've heard speak today, and maybe the one with the largest head. I don't know how you found one of these. It's unbelievable. I feel like Justin Timberlake, too, by the way, mixed with. But as he said, I'm a president of programming for MTV US, and what that essentially means is that I'm in charge of the creative, the development, conception and production of all of our series, films for the channel, and specials. So essentially, I'm a visual storyteller, and for me, it's really the most exciting job in the world, because ever since I was a little kid, literally, if my parents were here, they'll tell you that. Since I was about 4 years old, I wanted to make movies, and I was fascinated movies and TV and write, and I was always writing scripts, fascinated with the behind the scenes of storytelling. My dad took me to see The Exorcist when I was a little kid, when I was five, because he knew that I knew that it was Linda Blair and makeup, et cetera, so I didn't really see it as something that was frightening. I saw it more as art, and I saw it as brilliant technology being used to tell a story that when you read it, you were like, wow, how can they ever visualize this? So I've always been blown away by the advances in technology and how that has helped storytelling, how genius, innovation, inspiration, science, all of that comes together to really break and revolutionize the art form and take it to new levels. So as a visual storyteller, that's sort of the POV I'm coming at it with today, and I'm going to show you a couple of examples of things just to help illustrate where I'm going. You know, storytelling is really in our DNA. I mean, ever since we're kids, right, our parents are using stories to educate us, to soothe us, to put us to sleep, to entertain us. It's like part of our nourishment, like food, water, etc. It's really like music. I think it's a cross-cultural, universal language, and I think, you know, again, I'm not a historian, so some of these facts may be wrong, but this is my understanding of it, and this is the way I've always looked at it. Started out as folklore, word of mouth, and then really the first technological breakthrough, I think, is writing, right? Because that's where, you know, word of mouth, folklore, everybody was passing stories around, but, you know, there's always that game of telephone, something's missing here, etc. Writing, carvings, you know, really sort of took it to the next level, which was, you know, a record of this story. And then I think that the invention of ink and papyrus actually made storytelling mobile, right? So it allowed you to take your stories, get a record of them, get them out there. And then, you know, paper was a lot less expensive than papyrus and allowed you to create the novels and really make storytelling a little bit more in mass, more, you know, less expensive. And then, of course, the big sort of technological invention, I think, is the printing press in what, the 1400s, the Gutenberg press, roughly 1440, I think, that were suddenly, all of a sudden, novels were available to the masses, so people could get their ideas out to more people. So it's innovation that allowed people to get great ideas out to an even larger group of people and allowed them a lot of people to consume different ideas, and that led to thought, because all of this, all the storytelling is just inspiration. It's food for thought. It's taking you to new worlds, whether it's visual storytelling, written, etc. So, you know, then from there, obviously, there is the technological stuff like the typewriter, where it allowed, you know, an author like Dickens to do real-time typing and actually to produce his novels in installments and actually get real-time feedback. It's almost like the precursor to interactive storytelling. Then, of course, recordings. Radio, and then my favorite, I'm inspired by film, I always have been, that's been my prime inspiration and motivation to be in this business, and then film with sound, and if you can imagine an audience in the 30s suddenly seeing a bestseller like Gone with the Wind suddenly adapted into a new medium with technology on celluloid film, in color, with sound, on a big screen, it must have been just mind-blowing. And then the addition of special effects, another technological invention, allowed you to go to new worlds and see things that you would never have imagined you could see outside of maybe art and your brain. Things like King Kong or The Wizard of Oz, which actually I just revisited again recently, was blown away by the special effects in that and how amazing they were and how it really created an alternate experience in a new world. Animation allowed you to have non-human characters and taking you to other places. Again, another great innovation. And then, of course, TV. Sort of brought us into a global village. mostly live, but it got everybody in their household watching things live at the same time. Again, remember, that was, you know, pre-DVRs, et cetera. Everything was happening in a linear sort of fashion as it happened. And then I think, you know, home movie cameras allowed people to start to begin to sort of take, you know, shoot their own lives and sort of capture and make their own quote-unquote reality shows. But back then, they were all on film, 16-millimeter film, 8-millimeter film, no sound, et cetera. So really, I think that the home video camera was probably the technological invention that really started leading to cinema verite practice in television, but also in film. In television for reality and documentary, but then also in verite for scripted and for documentary filmmaking. And then I think that becoming a consumer market thing probably started in the late 70s, mid 70s, but they're really heavy. And I remember the Beta movie camera was the thing for your home, where you could put the Betamax tape inside. But I think when it really started becoming a camera that consumers could own at home, that was where it really revolutionized things, and people could start really making reality versions of their own lives. And so, as somebody who's worked at MTV, the turning point was when Sony came out with the PD-150 camera. That was a documentary camera that really was tiny. So it allowed you to go in, like one producer, you know, a 24-year-old producer we'd have, would be able to go in and capture real life in a really interesting, unobtrusive way. And it was used heavily in our series, True Life. So it really was amazing because it allowed us to really feel, it allowed the person or the subject that was being shot to really forget about the camera. So that was a really tremendous technological invention for us. But, you know, again, video then, as great as that was, it still felt like video, felt like documentary. And then me being a film buff, and all of us at MTV always want to reinvent, we wanted to see if we could take a documentary and shoot it like a film and use the visual language of film. And we wouldn't have been able to do it until 2004, when there was the invention of the Panasonic Pro DVC-50 that allowed you to have this sort of filmic, cinematic appeal, visual language to documentary, and I think it really altered the perspective of what you could do in documentary. And I have an example of the clip just to show you guys and refresh your memory.
Dude, this thing is so gnarly. This reminds me of the houses on the OC. Oh my god.
Maybe this is the jacuzzi?
Look how many people are down on the beach right now. No, the jacuzzi's over there. Let's go sit in the jacuzzi. Like, it's gonna be so nice.
Just like my old one.
Jets right now. I can just picture this. Ah.
Oh. It's Kristen's house.
Where?
Right there.
You can have a nice little room up in San Francisco and come back to this place.
Oh my god. I'm not gonna wanna leave.
You're not gonna wanna leave up there?
Dude, I'm not gonna wanna leave here.
And now. Pretty sweet.
That was something for me where I really was inspired, because I was like, wow, a piece of technology allowed us to take the documentary form and use and genre bust and combine it with the sort of the visual aesthetic of film. And that really was, you know, just a documentary scene. Now, it's sort of come full circle, because in the years since 2004, there's been the proliferation of all the home consumer cameras, and everybody is documenting their lives in real time. And what was interesting was, do you guys know Jackass, the movie here? Do you guys know Jackass, Steve-O? Well, Steve-O went through a really hard time. He was a really heavy-duty drug addict during that whole time period, and he was documenting every moment of it. So this documentary film that we had made was probably the first time I'd ever seen where it wasn't somebody telling us a story and that we had missed all the backstory. Because he grew up in the era of consumer video, he documented his entire downfall. And I have the 30-second promo here that'll just give you the example, but for us, this aired this year, and it was just really interesting because it again showed that people are documenting their lives in a different way now with technology.
I'm Steve-O, and I'm an alcoholic drug addict. I remember, like, being very young, and everything I looked up to was sex, drugs, and rock and roll.
He was either going to end up incarcerated, dead, or famous.
He was headed to a disaster.
And I had cameras rolling just about the whole time. All the way to rock bottom.
From his rise to fame to the horrors of addiction, Steve-O comes clean in his self-documented road to recovery.
I desperately needed to create a new history.
Steve-O, Demise and Rise, premieres Sunday, May 3rd at 10.
That was actually, so that was last May. And what was interesting here was technology built to a point where the image got better and better, right? And that was Laguna Beach. I thought that was a very interesting, very good quality image. You'd think the next step is to go even further in quality of image, but actually it went the other way. It was the idea of suddenly having more affordable, easy to use technology that allowed the aesthetic to be more real as the antithesis of that sort of cinematic slick look. And but what it bought you in return, you didn't get the slick look, but you got an authenticity and a voyeurism that you never really got before, and it was self-documentation. So that was the first time I'd ever seen that before for our audience, and this film really worked for us. Now, moving away from camera technology, new media, YouTube, social networking, Twitter, et cetera, you know, allows the Facebook generation to really do real-time publishing of every facet of their lives, right? So they're now back to folklore. They're telling their own stories. Everybody's doing their own reality show. And what I thought was interesting here was this year, we have this big yearly event we do called the Video Music Awards. And this year, Taylor Swift, who is a young new artist, had won the first award. She was so excited. It was her dream ever since she was a little kid to win this award. She goes upstairs up to get the award up on the stage. And Kanye West, who I think you guys know, who's very talented yet volatile hip-hop artist, ran up and took her moment. So this first is what I want to show you, what people saw live on TV. This is the moment on TV.
And the Moon Man for Best Female Video goes to Taylor Swift.
About what it would be like to maybe win one of these someday, but I never actually thought that would happen. I sing country music, so thank you so much for giving me a chance to win a VMA award.
Yo, Taylor, I'm really happy for you. I'm gonna let you finish, but Beyonce had one of the best videos of all time. One of the best videos of all time.
So, awkward yet great television moment. But this is two different things here. Now, this here you see, this is the Live Video Music Awards, which still works for us on linear TV in a traditional way, because live events like this that are very high profile still bring people back in that global community when everybody's really off, normally watching their own programming on DVRs, et cetera. But what we need to do in this new world right now with Facebook, Twitter, et cetera, is it offers up challenges to us, like it affects the economic model of television, the fact that people are watching TV while they're doing other stuff, et cetera. But it also offers up the opportunity for innovation for every screen and rethinking what we do once again with technology. So what we did was we had the idea while the VMAs were happening, we wanted to do live Twitter that was going on at the exact same time. But we've all seen Twitter, right? And we've all seen it's just, words on screen, et cetera. We came up with this idea to visualize the Twitter. So I'm going to imagine this was happening live that night. The 7:10 p.m. is roughly when the pre-show started. I can drag this along now. We had little boxes of every single piece of talent, everybody who was there that day. And they got bigger and smaller based on what everybody was talking about. We got 2 million tweets this night. But now you'll see what happened here. The pre-show happened. The main show started at 9 o'clock, and for anybody who saw it, Madonna came out and did a moment about Michael Jackson. Now you'll slowly see, out of nowhere, Madonna pops up, so all of a sudden the Twitterverse is all about her. Now the first award, when the first award comes in, out of nowhere, you start seeing the story of, oh my God. So Kanye just all of a sudden, so now even like if you were watching just this and you were doing the tweeting and you're like, whoa, man, something's going on. What is this? Then you put on the TV and you see it. Now let's imagine for people on the West Coast, we don't do a dual feed. So We air everything on the West Coast 3 hours later. So say somebody on the West Coast is watching the Twitter feed online. They see this. They're calling their friends. So the people, all of a sudden, this entire Twitterverse of 2 million of our viewers is telling the story in their own words of what's going on. And it's like, and you can almost see it visually here. You see it's Kanye, it's Taylor here. I mean, there's a lot going on. But you know right at this moment, some massive stuff just happened right here. And then if you can click on it, see there's, yeah, so both of them kind of just hit big. Hold on. Right at the moment when it all happened, but I'm sorry, my fingers are not hanging on to this well. And then if you were able to click on Kanye, you got to see what was going on, what was the moment. You could hear what somebody said about him. You can go into the actual feeds, but what we thought was interesting to hear was two things. It told us the story of what the world was saying about our own show, and it also allowed us to go back in time in Twitter and have a sort of Twitter record of the entire show as well on a variety of levels that are dimensionalized. So I thought what was interesting here is almost like we've come full circle back to folklore and everybody's their own storyteller once again. So that I thought was an interesting piece of technology that we're continuing to use, augmenting the linear TV experience with new media. And this last piece I wanted to show you was I wanted to give you a sneak peek, since we're here, of a show that's not launching until next year. But what's interesting here is it combines all of the pieces of storytelling we're talking about. Folklore, new media, handmade production, and I think a sort of a sentiment that our entire audience is really feeling right now, our youthful audience, is a feeling of hopefulness and aspiration, wanting to team up and help each other and do good. And it's called The Buried Life, and it's these four guys we found out of Canada that had a web sort of following, that they were basically going around the country checking off a list of things that they wanted to do before they died, but they're also listening to stories as they go across the country, and they're hearing stories from people about what they want to do, what dreams they want to have succeed. And for everything that these guys do, they help out one of these other people, these strangers. So here's a sneak peek at this, The Buried Life.
If you had one day to live, what would you do? Would you climb a mountain? Would you kiss the girl of your dreams? Would you tell someone how you really feel? Now, if you had a whole lifetime to live, would you lose that drive? Or would your list just keep getting longer? Hi, my name's Ben, and these are my friends. This is Johnny, the smartest kid I know. He's the brains of the operation, and the kind of guy the girls just seem to fall in love with.
It's one of those things in life, you just gotta, like, this is the thing they gotta do.
Duncan, his older brother, the heart of gold.
You gotta find the toys you want, right?
Yeah.
Bit of a wild card, but never lets us forget what we're here to do.
That's why we want to inspire people, get off the couch and talk to people.
Dave, the one-man party. Always a laugh. Up for anything, the crazier, the better.
Get it back on that ball!
And this is me, Ben, the hustler, the networker, the ringleader. I'll do whatever it takes to get the job done.
Not that way!
Even if it kills me. 3 years ago, we were fed up with racing through life without direction. Something was missing. So we made a list of everything we wanted most in life and went after it. We found the bus of our dreams, fixed her up, and hit the road. Our goal is simple. Complete our list and help others along the way.
I'm a gorilla, I spit to the boy filler. Cause honestly, I fill the radio with straight filler. If north is up and south is down, why 5 minutes is walking it out? That's not a jab at home. Like, I don't think the PD is reasonable.
You never know what's coming next, but we always seem to enjoy ourselves. For everything we do on our list, we help a stranger do something on theirs. And our journey has only just begun.
I'd like to win the lotto and just randomly walk around the world and help people that need it.
I secretly write music, and I want to get it out to everybody.
You go snowboarding with Sean White.
I'd love to qualify for a supercross race.
I think to say I love you to my mom.
To everybody who doesn't have a pair of shoes in America, I want to put a pair of shoes on them. Why? Because I want to be the soul of America.
These lists are our lives. They define us. They bring us together. And in them, we share our dreams, our successes, and our innermost desires.
Well, I want to show her that I can do something that's greater, bigger than the world.
Sometimes all we need to make them real.
There's nothing in the world
that will stop you from doing these things one day
is a little help.
And I believe miracles happen every day. We just need to remember to watch them.
We don't know where we'll be next, but when we come to your hometown, you know we're gonna ask, what do you want to do before you die?
There's a living, breathing, ongoing story that these guys are making themselves, they're shooting it themselves, and we're just giving them a platform. So that's really it. I hope it all made sense. I was trying to move as fast as possible. I don't. There's probably some stuff I slammed right through and wasn't clear on, but I'm sorry. I just flew in today, by the way, from New York, so I'm foggy. I just want to say again, thank you so much for having me here. I loved it. Loved being here. Thank you so much. Thanks so much.